Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks for joining us on the show. You've likely heard quite a bit of buzz around photobiomodulation, but can light exposure significantly improve our sleep, recovery, and performance? Well, there are more than 15,000 studies exploring photobiomodulation as a healing modality. But despite an abundance of research, the effects of light on our health have been largely overlooked in the past few decades. Now, we're becoming more aware of how artificial light can disrupt our circadian rhythm, but certain wavelengths of infrared and near-infrared light used therapeutically can also have profound positive effects on our performance and overall well-being. And as we'll discuss today, the uses for near-infrared light go well beyond health to explore the deeper mysteries in our cosmos. I'm honored to be here today with Bjørn Ekeberg, PhD, author of the groundbreaking book, Metaphysical Experiments, and co-founder and CEO of Recharge Health, the creators of the world's first targeted infrared therapy device, the FlexBeam. This episode with Bjørn gets heady. You're going to dig this one. But before we get there, if you're in search of vibrant health, one area that doesn't get enough attention is getting high quality, consistent sleep. For most of us, the absurd amount of artificial light hitting our eyeballs all night from phones, TVs, tablets, and computers can jack up our circadian rhythm and wreak havoc on our health. If it's not managed in some way, these pesky artificial lights beaming into our eyes can mess with our nervous systems, causing eye strain and headaches, and also disrupt our sleep patterns. Now, it would be great if we could just turn off all technology and devices at sundown, but that's not always a very realistic expectation for most people, myself included. So here are a couple of ideas of other things that you could try. Number one, check your device settings or look into installing an app that automatically adjusts your display color to remove the blue light in the evening. One thing that most people forget as well is to turn down the brightness in the evening after sundown. That's something that's extremely important as well. Even if you're using one of these apps, whether you have an Apple, Android, you're using a tablet or computers, you could either go into the built-in settings and pull that blue light out of your screen or use an app to kind of do all of this automatically as well. But make sure that you're manually also turning down the brightness of your screens, whether you're on a mobile device or your computers. That can really help with the disruption to your circadian rhythm that often happens and the inhibition of melatonin, yada, 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 all of the other things that go along with that. Number two, I also find it's very beneficial for sleep to use high quality blue blocking glasses and lenses in the evening to minimize the most problematic wavelengths of artificial light from our devices as well as ambient light sources. And after trying dozens and dozens of different kinds of blue blocking glasses and lenses over the years, one of the things that I've learned is that the quality of your lenses matters more than anything else. And most of the blue blocking glasses and lenses that you find out there on Amazon or in stores are not very good quality and do not live up to their promises. So shameless plug alert, after trying many, many different blue blocking glasses of various quality, most of which didn't work well at all, we decided to partner up with a team of specialists to create blue blocking glasses with premium lenses called Wild RX, and you can find them at wildrx.com. Our Wild RX glasses utilize patented melanin pigments built directly into the lenses, which help block and protect your eyes better, while also allowing you to see other colors more clearly. I think you're going to dig them. We have daytime yellow lenses, which are great for getting started. And if you'd like the most blue light protection, then check out our nighttime red tinted lenses as well. Right now, you can save 20% off your first order by typing in this special code at checkout, WILD20. That's WILD20. All one word. You can also get more than one pair of Wild RX glasses if you'd like to and still get that 20% off. So if you'd like to try the yellow tinted daytime lenses, which I wear most of the time, and try the red tinted nighttime lenses for ultimate blue blocking protection, I highly encourage you to do so. Every purchase that you make helps support this free show. We even have prescription corrected lenses at wildrx.com as an option as well. So please go to wildrx.com and don't forget to use that code WILD20 at checkout for an extra 20% off. All right, onto this show with Bjørn. We're chatting about how to use near-infrared light for rapid healing, deep meditation, and down-regulating our nervous system before sleep, why athletes are using red light for recovery, how to counter the negative effects of artificial blue light, why cosmology and our understanding of the nature of the universe is in a crisis, how near-infrared is used to peer deeper into the cosmos, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Bjorn. Welcome back, folks. Today, we're here with Bjørn Ekeberg, co-founder and CEO of Recharge Health, the creators of the world's first targeted infrared therapy device, the FlexBeam, with a PhD in philosophy of science, as well as the author of the groundbreaking book, Metaphysical Experiments. Bjørn is an unorthodox thinker who enjoys challenging the unquestionable and promoting newer and better ways of understanding and living. Hey, Bjørn, how's it going?
Oh, good, man. Thank you for having me on.
Absolutely. I'm stoked to talk to you. Let's start with how the importance of light for our own health has been very much overlooked in the past few decades, though there is a lot of research behind it and there's a lot of understanding. There's also a lot that we don't know. And some of the things that you've been exploring are looking at an entire paradigm shift in the way we think about light and human health. So why don't we start right there?
Yeah, I mean, it's an exciting time. And I think that you are among sort of pioneers and messengers into a new way to understand our health, really, in a broader perspective. I think we've lived with a very sort of biochemical and molecular kind of approach to health for a long time. But it didn't used to be this way. So when you look in sort of back in history, 100 years ago, if you had a lot of health issues, you'd often be sent to what was called a sanatorium, or a place that you would go to get sun and salt. And I mean, basically a sort of a boot camp for your health, right? And we don't have to get into the whole story of how we got there, but something happened in the 20s and 30s and the shift toward a more pharmaceutically dominated medical industry. And I think over the decades, people lost sight of one of the most basic facets of what it means to be a living being on Earth, is our relationship to the sun. The sun is this, you know, cosmic fireball of energy. And we have this very reduced conception of it. You know, it's like we think of it as, like, oh, we have to get enough vitamin D or these kinds of things. We don't actually appreciate. It's hard to maybe put your head around or wrap your head around how important the sun is as the be all and end all of everything we do, and how much energy is in it. So a lot of that energy, it turns out, a lot of its wavelengths that we can measure them by have physiological impacts. And this is a very exciting kind of break in science. It's not very new. It's not a new discovery, but it's kind of coming to light, if you could use that metaphor.
Oh, come on, Bjørn.
Yeah. And I think that's a very exciting time to be talking about health and being able to bring new technology to market as well that really can help people in ways that they did not anticipate at all, or most people had like no idea that light can do this, can have this kind of power.
And as you said, this has been going on for some time. There are thousands, I think I've heard you say before, over 15,000 studies around photobiomodulation or light as a healing modality on PubMed. Not that all studies and research is created equal, but at the same time, it does seem that it's been swept under the rug, so to speak, for many years. And just now is kind of, or in the past few years, there has been kind of this revolution of all sorts of devices that you see all over Amazon of mostly low quality. You see a lot of people talking about this for maybe the first time. So for people who are a little bit new to this whole thinking around light, what could you offer them in terms of the history of how we got here, and also kind of the revolution in LEDs that enabled red light and near infrared, but also kind of sacrificed our health when it comes to indoor and outdoor lighting?
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge story, right, around the sun's impact on us, because it's the one thing we ignore.
Yeah.
Because we just take it for granted. Like a lot of things, it's a human bias, right? So it's there all the time, so you don't think about sort of the energy it gives. It turns out that different wavelengths impact you differently, to put it simply. So, I mean, blue light, green light, there's all kinds of things, and also invisible forms of light, especially. They have physiological impacts on us. And that's what the umbrella term photobiomodulation is, this academic term for how light affects physiology. There is a bandwidth, or there's two bandwidths in particular, that have shown enormous promise and that are driving sort of a lot of the buzz around these kinds of devices. And that is red light at the far end of the visible spectrum. And it's near infrared light, which is invisible, but it has what you could feel as a warming kind of effect. Basically, the sun emits on Earth over 50% of the energy that comes from the sun is in the infrared range. Infrared is it's a large bandwidth that has to do with heat, essentially. And so near infrared has been studied now for several decades. And it turns out that it creates a certain response in the mitochondria in your cells. I know you had Jack Cruz and other leaders in the field on the podcast before and talking about this in depth with more scientific knowledge than I'm able to provide, but it's a very clear consensus from all of these studies that something happens at the cellular level, and the mitochondria are basically the energy generators of the cell. So the net effect of being stimulated, if you have the right kind of device, wavelengths, and output, you basically stimulate the cells to produce more energy at the cellular level. And the body's natural process, the body is a machine for recovery, right? Or it's a, you know, maybe machine is not the right word, but it's a, like it is incredibly proficient at healing and recovering. That's what it does all the time. And it turns out that near infrared light basically triggers this process to go a lot faster and be more efficient. And, you know, that's an exciting discovery, I think.
Yes, absolutely. But at the same time, more isn't always better. As with the sun, you don't want to go out there all day and get burned. Similar concepts are at work when you're talking about near infrared and red light as well, correct?
That's right. There's a certain kind of dosage amount. We've done a lot of research into this, and that's, you know, a lot of the research on photobiomodulation is about where you can find effects and so on. So you need to have quite a powerful device, but you don't want to overuse it. Because what happens if you overuse it, if you spend hours doing it, then it's not dangerous, but you're just probably not getting an effect. Like your body adapts, basically. So for those of your listeners who are familiar with this concept of hormesis, for example, which is basically a stress response in the cell, it's analogous to how when you go to the gym, you are kind of creating hormesis when you are lifting hard weights, right? You're stressing your cells, your muscle cells, and then they bounce back stronger. It's the same principle that underlies near infrared light as well, that kind of stimulation. So it's important to get your dose right.
And what's interesting is that it can happen at a superficial level for the skin. It can go a bit deeper, and then it can go so deep that it you know, penetrates our organs and the cells within them and even our stomach. Maybe you can talk about that, the different, because that was one of the differentiating points when I first got a FlexBeam. I'm just like, what are all these different modes and what exactly different types of effect might it have if I use it and experiment in certain ways? So maybe you can talk about that next, because that opens up a whole can of worms.
Yeah, I mean, we might introduce the device is called FlexBeam, right? And I think you've been an avid user of this, I think, for quite a while. I'm showing you here. I have my own Abel. It's here.
Yeah. Awesome. We match.
So, I mean, we created this. I co-founded the company that when we discovered this technology, we had just the right sort of people in the mix. We were able to make a device ourselves, not go to a factory in China, but we could put it together ourselves. And the key idea here is that it hasn't been made portable or easy to use before. You can buy panels and you can buy light bulbs. But when we looked into the effect of light like this and how to really make it powerful and effective, one of the key principles is you need something that can go straight on your skin. So already when you are, say, 10 centimeters away from the panel, you know, 4 inches away, you have lost something like 90% of the effect of the light. Because infrared light is, it has long wavelengths, so it penetrates. And that's part of its power. That's why near infrared light is powerful, because you can actually reach into the body. So you can reach 2, 3, 4 inches in, depending on, you know, bone structure in the way and so on. So this means that you can really treat at a cellular level deep inside the body. And that's what we wanted to create, something that was super easy to use, portable, but had that effective component of nothing is lost. Right. And no radiation is lost. It literally just goes straight where you need it. And that's where we see the most powerful effects when you compare to sort of panels and these kinds of things. But one of the most effective ways, and you know, there are many applications because you can put it anywhere on your body that hurts basically, or that you want to give a boost. But you mentioned the stomach, right? And it is interesting that the light receptors we have in our body seems to be even more of them in the stomach, in the gut region, than anywhere else. And if you can penetrate, you know, underneath the outer layers and actually get into the gut, which you can with this kind of device, then you are able to shine a very powerful light on, you know, the core of your system in many ways. Like the gut, the microbiome. I know you talk a lot about this on your show. This is a very powerful way to sort of treat your core, so to speak. And you can get profound systemic effects from it.
And there's another issue with panels where if you're within the distance that's effective for the light, then oftentimes you're also within the distance of all of the pollution from EMFs. And that can cause all sorts of issues for people. It's somewhat studied, but we know that for the most part, EMFs that are kind of artificially created are not good for our body, not good for our physiology. So how is FlexBeam different in that sense?
I mean, we designed it to have virtually no EMF. And we tested this, like we've done, readings in our own lab to make sure that it doesn't. And the main principle is that it's battery driven. So there you reduce a lot of the EMFs. They actually come from electricity that they're plugged into the wall, and that each of the light pods are encased. So for anyone who's concerned with EMFs, this is like two of our co-founders were very concerned about it. So we took this into our original design as well.
And so when you're talking about the different modes, what sorts of effects, I know you work with a lot of athletes at the pro level, what are they experiencing when they try using this device on different modes, on different parts of the body?
Yeah, by modes, you mean the different settings that
yes.
we have? Or?
Yes.
Yeah. So we designed it with three settings. We wanted to make it super simple for people, but the settings are basically a feature how deep you want to go into the body, like where the issue is that you want to shine a light on, so to speak. And red light is a very powerful way to treat the skin level, skin and surface level. It responds very favorably to wavelengths between 625 and 635 nanometers. To produce more collagen and elastin and things that are very, you know, beneficial for quick skin recovery. So we put in one setting that is more skin surface, and then we put in more infrared in the second one. So it's both red and infrared. And we had a third setting that is the most powerful near infrared that we could plug into the device, and almost no red for really like deep tissue. So we differentiate these modes in terms of how deep you want to go. For most of our athletes that we have now a big focus on, that see it as the next generation of recovery device, you know, they opt for this instead of a massage gun or something like this, because they see that it's, in a way, it's more effective, and especially over time. They really use setting 2 and 3 for the most part, because that's the muscle-related, muscular skeletal issues. Then you need near-infrared light. So those are the key settings. We have some really exciting sports profiles that we got from Norway, who are now sort of superstars in their field in tennis and in football, as we say, you would say soccer, as well, big national stars here who are in the top tier in the world have been using it. Then they use it daily. And the main reason that they tell us is that it just improves their recovery process. Very simply put, so they're just quicker back between games, which is the, you know, a key for an athlete. But this is something the effects and that we've observed and that we're cataloging with studies and so on, and testimonials from our users, is this is not just something that gives a top athlete a few percentage points or a little marginal thing. The effect, as you know, of like proper infrared treatment, red light therapy, can be a kind of a game changer for certain kinds of conditions and health and so on. So it's hard to put numbers on. We try to do it for specific conditions, but we are very clear that this is something that is for everyone. Everyone can benefit. So when we focus on sports stars, it's not because top athletes is the only sort of target audience here, because they really can feel the impact on their body. They really test all kinds of things and they know instantly if something works or not. So their sort of validation that this is the real thing they want to take into their practice has been key for us.
Absolutely. Yeah, they're great at giving feedback and pretty quick to throw away things that don't work as well, yes. Right?
And to be honest, there's a lot of things that don't work that claim to, you know, solve all your problems and stuff. The whole recovery device space or recovery tech is filled with, you know, dubious claims as well. And that puts an onus on us to really try to back up what we can with our own science and strong references.
Yeah. And it's an investment of time. It requires an investment of time. And as someone who's been, you know, running a health focused podcast for more than 10 years, I've just had truckloads of gizmos and gadgets sent our way. And it's not really, even if it's something that's extremely expensive, if it doesn't really work that well, or I'm not convinced, I'm not going to use it. It's just going to sit in some box in the garage, and we've got to get rid of a bunch of boxes in the garage. So anyone who wants some devices that don't work that well, we've got plenty to give away. But the idea that you can just spend a few minutes a day, 10, 20 minutes engaging in red light therapy and actually achieve some sort of targeted effect, to me was revolutionary. Because I would say that 9 out of 10 of these devices, yeah, the massage guns work and certain red light panels can work. And I think there's absolutely a use case for them. And I use the panels on a regular basis as well for kind of different reasons. But man, when I got the FlexBeam for the first time back in 2020, I think one of the early prototypes, I think I was struggling with a knee issue on my right knee because I used to run marathons and I still was doing a heck of a lot of trail running up in the mountains of Colorado back then. And I noticed that, like you said, instead of it just nagging and kind of still hurting as I was starting my next run, if I was diligent about on mostly a daily basis, but it doesn't have to be every day, usually it would be after my runs, I would just put it around my right knee. And I could feel immediately that there was some sort of soothing action going on. That warmth was very comforting. Whereas in some cases, it can kind of be inflammatory. Like, you don't, if you have a knee injury, you don't want to take the massage gun on the highest setting and slam it against your knee. That's not going to work well. So I think that there's certainly a lot of promise there for those sorts of acute or nagging injuries. But also for me as a musician, or just standing here podcasting throughout the day with long hours, a lot of people who are on tech devices get the tech neck. And I find that it's very useful just running down the spine or put on the back. And it seems to keep that at bay as well.
Okay. The tech neck. I like that. I might use that.
No, I didn't come up with that one. It's so pervasive now that I think pretty much everyone knows what we're talking about with that.
Yeah. And it's a thing that, most people, especially sort of our age and up, able have something somewhere that they are hurting with or struggling with in some way, right? Whether it's a relatively minor ache or a bigger underlying condition of some kind. And that's, I mean, one of the reasons why we geared this essentially a medical device. It's a classified as a medical device in terms of how it's made and in terms of its therapeutic effect, but toward a sports and broader audience and people who are more health conscious, because it can give a lot of people who wouldn't otherwise identify with medical illness or like would go to a doctor or a physio for their neck. Like the tech neck is kind of like that, right? So you wouldn't think to sort of, now I need medical treatment and I need to buy expensive hours somewhere. FlexBeam will help those people too. But what we're trying to affect here with FlexBeam is to let people discover that there is a whole new approach to health, that you can do this even if you don't think of yourself as sick or ill.
Yeah, and I think it's through acknowledging that that is an important part of healing, is healing before you're broken, or keeping some of those problems, you know, trying to correct them on an ongoing basis instead of ultimately popping some painkiller, which we know will not be good for us. If you look at what the approach is from the modern medical establishment and institutions, generally it's going to be pill popping that treat the symptoms, or they're going to get in there and cut you open. And in a lot of cases, you don't want to be getting back surgery if you don't need it, or knee surgery and the rest of these things. It's really important to be able to heal in a different way that's less aggressive and potentially harmful against your own body. And something like red light and near infrared is really quite pleasant to use at the same time too. If you go in and you're constantly doing a deep tissue massage or the massage guns that we're kind of using as an example, sometimes that can be unpleasant at the, you know, extreme end of something that's helping you eventually. It's not enjoyable to use. Whereas I find that whether it's the panels, the FlexBeam, or some other red light devices, it's something where you kind of look forward to actually using this and incorporating it into your routine, or at least I do.
Yeah, and you're not alone in that. Actually, we have a lot of user stories and cases as we developed this, or after we developed it. And originally, as you know from the design, it's like bendable and super easy and flexible, so you can attach it to somewhere. And the idea, as I explained before, is that you can, you know, if you wrap this around an elbow or a knee, then you can get light from three different angles. And because they penetrate, you can get, you know, really powerful effects in certain locations. But then what we discovered when people were starting to use this, and, you know, people are creative and you give them something and it's like, okay, where do you put it? Like, you know, how will you use it? We found a lot of people use it almost for meditative purposes. And we discovered a supplementary use, which turned out to be quite powerful for a lot of people, is for sleep, or to help people relax before sleep. And so increasingly we get these stories back of people how, you know, how they like having the sort of me time with FlexBeam that is like 10 minutes that is just soothing, calming, it's stress relieving, all of those things. And it works like that too. We just didn't sort of design it for that. We designed it more hardcore for injuries, but because it's of its flexibility, it's, as you say, it's a pleasant treatment. So this makes it for a lot of people sort of a friend, you know, that you can take to bed with you.
For meditation, is that around the midsection, or were people putting it for that?
Yeah, for example, if you place it vertically, if you're sitting in a lotus sort of upright position, for example, you can literally just place it vertically over and just hold it and for 10 minutes while you're meditating, and then you are literally then shining a light on the gut microbiome in that area while you're relaxing your nervous system as well. I mean, I quite like it for myself, and a lot of people do. Individuals have different preferences, of course, but that's one common way.
And that would likely be on the deepest setting, number three, right?
Yeah, it would be deepest, or the second setting, which is sort of equal amounts red and near infrared, because red light is also quite beneficial for the gut.
Let's talk a little bit as well about blue light, artificial light, and that portion of the spectrum that I think a lot of people might be somewhat aware that it's not terribly good for us. But there are some tweaks that you can make, whether it's indoor lighting. Even in my studio, I changed the wavelengths of the lights that are beaming into my eyes. And after being on stage as a musician for a few decades there, I really started to get headaches, burnout from the wrong kind of wavelengths at the extreme end of the experience, just like beaming directly into your eyes. It's very obvious that it's not good for us. But even people who are staring into tablets, phones, computer screens, TVs, all the rest of it, or even just being around indoor lighting can be damaged and have their physiology affected by this kind of, not necessarily acutely, but cumulatively over time, this results in negative effects. So maybe you can riff on that a little bit next.
I mean, because the part of the issue here isn't particularly blue light as such. I mean, blue light is in the middle of the day. With sunshine is like just the peak of the daylight spectrum. And if you think of it, the sun's rays, like if we are out in nature, we get a complete spectrum. It tilts throughout the day, depending on how close you are to sunrise or sunset. But nobody has an adverse effect of being outside in blue light in that respect. When we talk about blue light, which is really, you know, a big social problem, we're talking about LED lighting indoors that has reduced or chopped off certain wavelengths in order to be more energy efficient. And then, you know, it wasn't studied for photobiomodulation, to put it this way. It was just done for other reasons that may have been very good reasons to introduce this, you know. But somehow we are living through the effects now. And I think the change happened, you know, invention in the 90s and then to the 2000s. And within our lifespan, like pretty much all indoor lighting has been switched over from old incandescent bulbs into these kinds of LEDs. And some of them can be, I think you're totally right in that prolonged exposure is specifically harmless. And if that's all you get, so if you live indoor, most of the time, most of the lighting you get is indoors, you are most likely going to be exposed to these sort of chopped off wavelengths and things that are not, your body reacts to in strange ways. You know, it's a sort of a large experiment. And I think we're beginning to see that, and there's more recognition of it. But how to, you know, reverse that trend, like to change your lights internally, right? So that's it's one consequence of a sort of a revolution in LEDs that has happened. We are benefiting from, there's a sort of a second revolution in LEDs that are concerned. Our device has to do with being able to compact a lot of energy into light bulbs that you couldn't otherwise before. So something like FlexBeam wouldn't be able to make it 10 years ago because the LEDs weren't strong enough and powerful enough, and those that were too expensive. So it's a bit of a mixed bag with LEDs. Like the artificial lighting we have indoors is definitely, like, it's problematic for health. But then there are also some very powerful effects that come from it if you have, let's say, the right part of the spectrum involved.
How has learning all of this affected your own day-to-day lifestyle, whether it's lighting inside the house, when you go outside, how you do, how has it changed your habits?
I mean, once you become really aware of something, it's hard to become unaware again.
Right.
So it changes habits in a very natural way. I am very concerned to get sunlight and be outside for parts of the day, even if the weather is not nice, just to have that exposure. I'm not, you know, overly concerned in daytime of, like, you know, ugly lighting is ugly, but it's, I don't think of ugly lighting as like, oh, it's necessarily killing my health.
Sure.
But I'm really concerned about nighttime, because I see that's the biggest disruption that can happen and that can change your circadian rhythm, impact sleep, and so on. That is exposure to sort of that cold, hard LED light in the last 2-3 hours before bed. So, I mean, I sometimes even use FlexBeam as a lamp because it's got this red light. The frequencies are, you know, very easy on the eye, or to have similar kind of bulbs in my house that are very warm. So try to avoid that cold light. And I hate refrigerators that don't have a night light.
Yeah.
So I don't know about you, but sometimes, like, in the evening, I need to get some, you know, a drink before bed or eat something, and it's like, you know, I hide behind the door when it opens. So just, I don't want to be, because it's, I'm sure there are fridges that you can change night light. I don't have such a one. It just blasts something. And, you know, having the sort of, I use a sleep tracker device like many people do. So I've been able to see the impact when that happens, you know?
Yes. Yeah. And I guess before you're aware of it, the way that we are today, it's something that kind of bugged me before, but those bright, harsh lights you go into a hotel, or like you said, refrigerator, and certainly electronics, these aren't designed for the sake of our health. It's important that people realize this. And the innovations, using air quotes, that have come to pass in the age of LEDs were really to save energy and save money for, you know, the hotel chains and for the refrigerator manufacturers, et cetera. And they didn't really look in the impact it might have on our own health and physiology. So it's important that people recognize that the changes that have happened aren't really progress in the sense of improving our human health, but they could be. You can make some modifications to achieve that end.
Yeah, I mean, for sure. We looked into the possibility of being able to use incandescent bulbs, which are more or less banned in many, many places, if it can be sold as a kind of medical device, because they had a very nice, they have a complete spectrum within the glow, like the regular old light bulbs. There are other reasons why we should not reintroduce it, maybe good reasons, but, you know, it was all a big experiment, and we're the guinea pigs of all of this lighting change. And so I think it puts a a particular onus on us to become conscious of our relationship to the sun and to natural daylight, and to have that as the base. You know, that's, you know, that's the core of the lighting you should have in daytime, and anything else is supplementary. But of course, not everyone has sort of access to the outdoors the way we live.
Yeah. Well, and now you're even seeing, and in the past few years as well, you're seeing Apple, manufacturers of Android phones, computers, et cetera, build in this software like night shift mode or night mode and flux and a few other different software approaches to this, which I found might be a little bit helpful, but really don't do the trick. And from some of the studies and research that I've read around it also, that kind of says, well, maybe it might be a step in the right direction, but it really doesn't do anything because most people don't turn down the brightness enough, and it's still not changing the fundamental nature of the screens. So we still have to wear blue blocking glasses if we want to help a little bit more. And that still isn't 100% there, but it's important that people recognize that it doesn't have to always be the worst case scenario, even if there are like small improvements that you can make through modifying software on your technology. If you still have to use it, certainly using it less after sundown, throwing on those blue blockers. There are steps that we can take to try to make this a little bit better if you're intentional about it.
Yeah, I agree. And a nightlight for the refrigerator, so I'll be happy. Yeah.
You'll have to invent that one next.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about your background in physics and in science and what we don't know, because I was reading a bit of your book, and I'd like to share just a couple of quotes that I wrote down here. In order to maintain a mathematically unified theory of the universe, we must accept that 95% of our cosmos is furnished by completely unknown elements and forces for which we have no empirical evidence whatsoever. What does that mean exactly to you?
Yeah, well, it means that what we think we know and the models and the theories we use to describe the universe have a lot of assumptions built into them and inventions in order to make them whole, right? That doesn't mean necessarily that they're right or wrong, but just that they come with a lot more complexity and complication and a lot of uncertainty than is usually thought of. When we talk about something like the Big Bang Theory, we've grown up in a world in which that's just how the universe is, how it got started. We all were told this story. So all of this research belongs to an earlier phase in my life. I was studying and had a chance to go in depth and do a lot of research from a philosophy of science angle. I'm not trained as a physicist or as a cosmologist, but trained as a philosopher and theorist and sort of historian overlapping. And I was very interested in looking at the foundations of what we think we know for sure. Like how well do we really know it, and what is it sort of based on? So with physics and cosmology, I would, you know, not look at the math, because to be honest, I try to understand some of it, but that's like too complicated for my training, but looking at the fundamental assumptions that usually are sort of not hidden away, but they're usually ignored by physicists, because they look at, okay, if X, Y, and Z, then we can run these calculations. So my concern was like, okay, how did we get to know these were the principles to start with and so on, and how well do we know them? And that's been an abiding interest for me since I started that research like 15 years ago. And the book you quoted from came out in 2019. I wrote a piece for Scientific American around that time, and sort of questioning where I thought that, to me, it looked like cosmology was in a bit of a crisis. I'm not the only one saying this, but I had a particular point of view. I was attacked by many people, but also made more friends, and I've been invited to debate and speak at various festivals, and I've continued sort of research on the side. I don't have much time for it these days with the company that I'm running, but it still is an interest I have in just that limit of knowledge around cosmology in particular. But cosmology is a branch of physics, right? And also theoretical physics has some of the same kinds of fundamental challenges when it comes to how well do we know what we know. And I guess the quote that you read out to say 95% of the universe consists of unknown things. These are things like dark matter, which many of you may have heard of, dark energy, and so on. When you add it all up, these things are necessary, or like something like that must exist if our model is right. That is what the Big Bang theory, which is a shorthand for like a very complicated framework, but like if you accept the generalization, that's what the theory tells you, that it has to be, that model has to be right, but our observations don't match. There's huge discrepancy between what we observe and what the model predicts. So therefore we introduced a lot of things into the model, such as dark matter and dark energy, to counteract it. And that makes up 95% of what we think the universe is. Now that's a relatively arresting starting point for a theory of the universe, right? Because we haven't found any, there's no empirical evidence of any like dark matter particles, for example. It's been decades of working on it, and there's, you know, lots of people are working on it, convinced it has to be there. But the reason a lot of people in the scientific community are convinced it has to be there is because they have this faith in the theoretical model to begin with, that if we just extend Einstein's general relativity, this beautiful theory of our own cosmos, and we extend it indefinitely to what we see, we have to be able to. So how, that's how it boils down to. It's like we can find the universal laws. Somehow physics come up with one explanation for everything. That's the part that I consider faith. And when you have that faith at the core, then you will accept things like, oh, well, dark matter, that's like 70% here, or, you know, this and that. So you need that kind of faith that we could find that solution in order to even build a model in the first place.
So there are dangers in being that compartmentalized, you know, when you're trained in a certain aspect of science, and then you need to accept these assumptions that drive pretty much all of your work. And if those assumptions are not true, then all of your education is in jeopardy, correct? So that presents a giant problem in the way that even people are taught in schools, whether it's science or other disciplines, because most people don't really embrace the interdisciplinary aspect of what it means to educate yourself. And I really have deep respect for people who go in that direction, like you and many others. I think it is becoming perhaps better accepted over the years. But maybe that's because these fundamental models are starting to break down.
Yeah, and they are increasingly. It's also an interesting shift happening now in cosmology, because we recently sent up this James Webb Space Telescope, which some of you may have heard of. It's like, you know, half of NASA's budget over 20 years went into creating this like amazing satellite telescope that is out there now providing images. And curiously enough, the technology they use to peer into the cosmos is near infrared, actually.
Interesting.
Yeah, they use these wavelengths. It's not exactly the same as in FlexBeam, but near infrared is used in order to, basically penetrate further, right? So to get information through dust and things that can be in the way. But some of the findings that have come back, and these are still preliminary, we've seen like new images. And some of the listeners may have seen headlines around this in the last year. Now we have new imagery that shows, for example, galaxies that are way older than the Big Bang would say that it's when the universe started. These kinds of things are clearly changing some of the discourse and sort of splitting that community, from my perspective, in two. Like the cosmologists who are working on these models are just trying to find ways to fit the new sightings in with the existing model. So basically changing the parameters a bit. And then there's an increasingly people who used to be only at the margins, who were saying for a long time that something is wrong more fundamentally. It's not about this particular aspect of the model. It's like there's a core problem here, right? Are starting to get a little bit more recognition, I think, in the community, that there might be a need for a rethink. But that's not so easy to do in science. A paradigm doesn't just shift because somebody has a different idea. That's a lot of hard work and a lot of people to mobilize and things. So it's not happening quickly, but it's a very interesting time in terms of, you know, how we understand the universe. There might be some big changes coming within the next 5 to 10 years, I think.
I hope so. speaking about telescopes, you mentioned in your book as well, scientists don't see through a telescope, they see with a telescope. Can you explain the difference between those two statements?
Yeah, it's the telescopes we use, and in analogy, also the kind of the microscopes we use with particle accelerators in the microphysics. It's the same principle that these are beyond what we can see, right? Like what we can see with the naked eye. So we invented these instruments that give us the ability to see further, right? But the images that come back from the James Webb Space Telescope, it's not like a photograph that it's a camera out there and snapping a photo and sending it back. These are reconstructions of data, of massive, massive amounts of data. And these reconstructions, they have to undergo a certain kind of filtering, right? And those filters in place in order to get some sort of signal out of all the noise that we're getting in. In order to get that kind of filter, you need to have a theoretical framework. Like you can't just clean it up on your computer hard drive or anything like this. You have to apply a certain kind of perspective. So already there you start, like in what you, the instrument that you are observing with already comes with assumptions, theoretical assumptions built in. So you are expecting to see certain things in a certain range, and you filter that data accordingly to, you know, make sure you get the kind of result you want. I'm oversimplifying it a bit, but it's like that process, it's not a clean snapshot of the sky. It is a very, very complex interrogative process, interpreting data to get the kind of images. And then it's reconstituted into like image forms and so on, which are the ones that are then, you know, distributed in media and so on. And I have to underline, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm not trying to say it's all bullshit or anything. I'm just, you know, trying to point out that these things are a lot more slippery than we think, and they're not as certain as we think. And there's actually a lot of reasons to believe we may have had some of the core assumptions that were all taught as scientifically proven may not actually be valid. In fact, something like the Big Bang itself lies far beyond the horizon of what can be experimentally verified. It is literally an article of faith or a first principle in order to do the work in cosmology. You could never prove it.
How do you reconcile faith with science, or how do you see scientists do that, or people who are deep into theology? Because that's a whole different conversation. But, you know, people hear the word science and they're like, OK, 110% correct. I accept everything. But that's not how it actually works, or nor how it should work.
No. And that's, you know, it's a sort of complex question. And it's like we have been taught, and I think even more strongly, maybe in the United States, anywhere, there is this perception of religion versus science. But actually, when you look at the historical development of science, religion and science always kind of worked in tandem. And what we now consider modern science is sort of has always been in a certain kind of relationship with theology and faith for centuries. That split has become clearer in the 20th century. We have scientists who most scientists would think of themselves as not doing metaphysics or theology and having nothing. They're just looking at data, like they're just doing empirical evidence. And what I'm trying to point out is that you are already making core assumption, you're framing the problem in a certain way, and you're smuggling in your own assumptions whenever you are interpreting data like that. Because we are not talking about, you know, a confined lab test of a, you know, a jar or something that you can do and have full control over. We're talking about observation of the largest possible extent of space, like cosmos. We're peering into outer galaxies. These are not controlled experiments. They are observations and interpretations. So, of course, there's an element of what you are projecting onto it, you are also going to find, right? And all of this brings complexity in. And I see faith as a driver in that kind of science. I don't mean then faith in the sense of which particular god you believe in, but that you have to have a sort of a core belief that we are able to produce this one universal theory that explains everything. That is what my book is about, the history of that, how it led up to the Big Bang, is that's an underlying source of faith for the development of that science. That science will find the mathematical answer and the universal theory. And I don't think that there's any real evidence to point to that that'll ever be the case. And if you look at it historically, that's not what happens. You have multiple overlapping models that work in different regions and space, but somehow, especially in physics, there's been always this drive since the inception of physics to find the one theory of everything and have it nailed in a mathematical formulation. You know, so that's what I would question.
But if you look at philosophy or religion, the concept, especially across the world, not so much in America, of unknowable, right? Like, it's not something that can be known, might be worth embracing in this case.
I mean, I personally think so. I think it's, not a hardcore scientist. I'm very fascinated by how science works and try to understand it as well as I can. But I have gotten to know a lot of scientists who feel almost fear at the prospect that our theory might be wrong or that we don't have the complete answer that we can nail. Because in many ways, it's about control. Like, once you have certain framework and you find that you can, you know, run it repeatedly with observations or experiment and you always get the same results, there's a sense that you control something, you know it really well. I, for one, I find it sort of delightful that we don't quite understand our cosmos.
Yeah.
And that it's more of a mystery. But that makes me not a scientist.
More, yeah. I'm with you on that one for sure. Embracing the magic in the world and trying to understand that we are not the smartest creature that has ever probably existed is liberating in some ways.
I mean, I think so. And like the humility that comes along with admitting that, well, maybe, you know what, maybe our complete understanding of the universe stuff, maybe it's a tall order to say that we are going to have a complete framework of understanding for these kinds of galaxies that we've observed in the last few decades. And if you go back a century, it's less than a century since we thought the universe was our own galaxy, right? And try to put this in context sometimes in terms of the scale. And it's like what we actually have observed and tested with general relativity is somewhere in the 0.1 to 0.5% of what we believe the whole thing is. So all that we have tested, and we know that these theories work really well in our solar system. In fact, I think you could use Newton's calculations to safely land on the moon or even find your way to Mars. They work well within our region. But when you extend this further and further, and you realize that the universe that we're sitting in and we're observing is just this tiny little fraction of this droplet into this vast ocean, and the only way that we can calculate how big that ocean is through those assumptions we make from this little droplet in space. If you try to spatialize how big space is, which is very, very hard, some of the arguments for the certainty of this and the scientific rigor behind it and all of it, it just becomes less and less plausible, or at least it's plausible that we're totally wrong, or that things are very different, a little bit further out than we think. And indeed, I think this is what a lot of the observations are telling us and why the framework is struggling to actually make sense of it, because there's so many discrepancies. It doesn't fit into one model. But still, we're chasing that one, the one big explanation for everything, right? So that's where the faith comes in.
Well, I would love to keep talking about this, but in the couple minutes we have left here, what is coming next for Recharge and FlexBeam? I've heard a few rumors that excite me about the ability of the device to actually understand a little bit more about what's happening in the body that it's trying to treat. So maybe you can just talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, certainly. It's like one paradigm shift to another paradigm shift in a way.
Yeah.
From like in the skies and to health, which I'm really sort of excited to be part of as well, and on your show, among others, to sort of help share some of this knowledge and to provide something that people can use. And you know, when I first met sort of my co-founders, they had just come across this technology and they thought they could use it. And I think that they could make something with it. I think we all struggle to understand, and I certainly scratch my head and said, like, given these profound physiological effects from this kind of light exposure and so on, it seems science is very clear and we could notice it ourselves. Like, why haven't we heard about this before? Like, why is it a sort of cottage industry? Like, it's buzzing in people, like if you search for red light therapy, but it's only for those people who already know. If you're into biohacking, you heard about it, but it's very marginal. Most people have no idea. And for me, the answer is that we haven't made it accessible and available enough. Like that it still is a bit of a, like you have to kind of be really into it and sort of design your own wall at home. And like, if you're a hobby, if you're an enthusiast, you can do it. You can get this technology. But for most people, and especially in our age, it has to kind of be made so easy and available that it's a no-brainer to use. So with FlexBeam, we made the first step toward, you know, making something that's portable and that like bends around wherever you want to use it and like super easy to use, just plug and go. But where we see the development going, and in order to make, to spread this further, is to develop a device like FlexBeam, but that also has that sort of smart component of sensors and ability to integrate data. Many people have tracking devices of some sort. They already are starting. That's a bit of a revolution where we have sort of metrics on ourselves. So, and if you can combine that with some data from FlexBeam also on how it works underneath the skin, it will really help for people to not only keep track of their health, but to realize what is actually happening. Right. This is one of the challenges we have, and I'm sure maybe you've come across this if you've given it to for other people to try as well. It's like, okay, it's the treatment is sort of invisible and it happens underneath your skin. And very rarely is it a case of you just put it on for 10 minutes and you feel amazing right after. It's very often that's like you're treating something, you have to sleep and you feel better the next day. And if you keep using it, you will definitely notice results. But it's not an instant thing. So we want to help make clear to people what happens under the skin. What happens when the mitochondria react this way? How can we visualize it? How can we show you data that is actually making a difference? Right. So this is something we're working on integrating in a version 2. And that would then also have a sort of a very user-oriented app alongside of it. So it'd be easy for you to find, like if you wanted to treat your tennis elbow, you basically just say, okay, I have a tennis elbow. And they will come back to like, okay, use it this way and I'll keep track for you, right? All in all, what I'm saying is simplifying the way you can relate to the device, making it super easy to use. And our goal is to have something that people put on their either their nightstand or living room table or something. It's just a device you have at home because you can use it for all kinds of things. So we started with this sort of big, hairy, ambitious goal, or the vision or the moonshot of the company was that one day, hopefully not so long from now, this has become, like the awareness of this has become mainstream enough that this is just something people have. This is something you want to have at home when you can use it for all kinds of things. And think about families that have, you know, kids running around hurting themselves and one partner wants to relax before bed and another is like out running. Like, if you make this accessible enough for people, I think everybody's going to want one. So that's what we're trying to accomplish now with version 2, having demonstrated with version 1 that this actually is a thing and there's a market for it and people love it. Let's make it even better and more user-friendly and make it the device that everyone will have.
Really exciting stuff. Bjørn, what is the best place for people to find Recharge, the FlexBeam, and the rest of your work?
So our global online web shop is recharge.health. Quite simply that URL, recharge.health, and that's where you can buy FlexBeam from anywhere in the world. I believe we can give your listeners a special discount with a link in the show notes as well.
Awesome.
And we offer a 60-day open purchase, so to speak, so it's easy to try. We can do this because almost nobody wants to return it. But so you can safely try it if you're curious for yourself. And I wish everybody luck. Check it out for yourself and see what people are talking about.
Well, Bjørn, so much fun to talk to you. Thank you for pushing this field and many others forward.
No, thank you, Abel, and for inspiring lots of people to think about their health differently and more smartly and to take health into our own hands. That's really part of the paradigm shift, if you will.
Hey there, thanks so much for joining us on this episode of the Fat Burning Man Show. Before you go, please hit like and subscribe, or even better, leave us a quick review, which helps other people find their way to this free show.
We've recorded over 400 episodes of this award-winning show over the past decade and change, and you can watch every single episode for free at fatburningman.com. So if you can think of a friend or a family member who might enjoy and benefit from our work, please take a quick second to share it with someone you care about. Thank you so much for all of your reviews, comments, likes, emails, and the kind words you send our way. We couldn't do any of this without you. Now, a quick disclaimer. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects and is not intended as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Now, before I sign off, don't forget to join our newsletter at fatburningman.com. When you sign up with your email, I'll send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes. This is Abel James signing off. Thanks so much for listening and have a great week.